at the Barber Vintage Motorcycle Sports Museum in Birmingham, Alabama, one of the greatest chapters in motorcycling is being reconstructed.
You're going to have to take your friendly reminder off of this gas tank.
Yeah, well, better safe than sorry.
They are carefully assembling one of the rarest motorcycles in the world, a Briton. One of only 10 Briton motorcycles in existence. Champion racer Chuck Honeycutt and museum mechanic Joe Bruton prepare the legendary bike for a run around the track.
Yeah, I'm in. This is just about the only one left running, isn't it? Everyone else has put theirs up?
I think so, yeah.
Well, I'm glad we still get to play with ours.
Joe is right. This is the only roadworthy Briton left. The rest have been put out to pasture as pampered showpieces in private collections.
There's nothing like the sound of a Briton at 12,000 RPM.
If only a handful were ever built, and only one of them still running, why does an obscure racing bike that looked like it jumped out of a tropical fish tank qualify as one of the world's greatest motorcycles?
Oh, yeah. Perfect.
Because of one man, New Zealander John Briton, a soft-spoken genius who single-handedly took on the world's largest motorcycle makers and beat them in his own garage. The year is 1991. The place, Daytona Speedway, the red-blooded American capital of motorized racing. It's the home of the Stock Car Super Bowl, NASCAR's Daytona 500, and it's where the biggest races in U.S. motorcycling take place. Briton took a Ducati engine, lashed it to a chassis of his own design, and traveled halfway around the globe to race it in Daytona's Battle of the Twins. He shocked the racing world by taking second place. But it wasn't good enough for a man who designed and built his own house and had been restoring, rebuilding, and racing motorcycles since he was a wee little Kiwi. He went back to New Zealand and challenged himself to do the impossible. Returned to Daytona the following year with a motorcycle completely of his own design.
He decided he'd start from first principles and just go absolutely from the beginning without any thought of what had been before. By being able to do the whole thing from scratch, he was able to be right on that cutting edge.
The first thing he did was build a wireframe model of the motorcycle he already had running through his mind.
If I've got any talent at all, it's probably I'm pretty good at visualizing a finished product before it exists. I can visualize a motorbike pretty well detailed before it's built. My other forte is knowing the shortcuts. I'm very good at cheating, cheating my way through something to keep the cost down.
Boy, bodywork with air going through it. You know, I don't know of any other motorcycle that's been smart enough to do that.
The way the downforce, where they've incorporated the ground effects on a motorcycle, and with the wings being in the middle of the bike, pushes the whole motorcycle down at speed.
Aerodynamics was the key. Mostly ignored by other motorcycle manufacturers, Briton found design inspiration in the world of Formula One.
I'm trying to get an air supply into that low pressure area. So it's coming through that ducting there, through the radiator, cooling the engine, and then out into this low pressure area.
Like their race cars, he would use airflow to keep his bike glued to the track. No one had ever done this before on a motorcycle. For John Briton, it was easy to break the rules. They were just like the nearest motorcycle factory, thousands of miles away. Necessity being the mother of John's invention, he made do with what was lying around. He cast the housing and other parts of the engine in his wife's kiln.
Believe it. It's not water. Excuse me. Get some more water from the swimming pool.
Overall, he manufactured by hand a mind-numbing 6,000 separate parts and pieces.
be happy, boys. This represents like 4 months' work building these plugs. It's taken 4 months.
I reckon it's doing bloody well. Carbon fiber, so.
For the frame, John went with a combination of steel and carbon fiber, which is extremely light and very strong. It was not, as he discovered, fireproof.
Oh, interesting. Interesting concept.
With 3 months until Daytona, the clock was beginning to tick a lot louder.
Oh, just so far behind here. You're freaking me out, actually. Dangerously behind.
It was always the last minute push. Things were never ready, you know, 2 months in advance, the testing all done and, you know, all packed up, ready to go. It was always the night before. Sometimes they were still out on the track testing that last change he wanted to make.
Finally, with D-Day 6 weeks away, a sleep-deprived, nerve-wracked John Britton prepared to watch his homegrown high-tech baby take its first racing steps. Test driver Chris Holder hit the throttle. Then the unimaginable occurred. The carbon fiber down tube snapped in two. Britton had miscalculated. The frame was too light for his torque-heavy engine.
Oh, that was the worst experience. It was a devastating thing for me. I just about gave up. I had given up for 6 or 8 hours. I'd canned the whole project. You know, climbed back on the horse and kept on going, really. We felt, well, we'd come so far. And within a few weeks, we had made a slightly safer version of what we'd designed, and we've had absolutely not a jot of problems with it ever since.
Daytona Speed Week, 1992. 1 year after vowing to return with a bike of his own creation, John Britton was back with a motorcycle like no other.
Arriving at Daytona with the big bike manufacturers with their triple semi trailers and, you know, everything very beautiful, and there's the Britton in one box, one stainless crate, you know. So we kind of felt small.
But as soon as word got out, Britton's bike was big news. The bike was all the buzz.
Check the swinging arm. I mean, this thing is so exotic. It's got to be the ultimate new. It's got to be the idea, huh?
That is the most awesome motorcycle here in Daytona. Absolutely.
A mechanic's dream, that's what it is.
But the motorcycle gods seemed determined to make John pay for his bold creation. On a final test run the day before its Battle of the Twins racing debut, a cracked cylinder sleeve put the Britton out of commission. With the mechanics party going full blast in his borrowed garage space, John set up shop to try and fix his broken dream.
It's good not to panic, but just be resourceful.
A homemade remedy of soldering and brazing brought the cracked cylinder back to health. And the next morning, the Britton V1000 motorcycle roared back to life. With absolute amazement, John watched his two-wheeled namesake shoot to the front of the pack, settling into second place before hitting the first turn. There was no doubt, the one-off from down under can run with the big boys. The driver has a hard time keeping the front wheel down in any gear.
You watch us catch up here. We've got more power here, you watch.
The Britton racer pulls up alongside the seasoned front runner and pops an in-your-face wheelie.
Far out, did you see that?
It's a moment of triumph. Britton, the new bad boy on the block, announcing to the world right here with the Ducatis, Hondas, and Yamahas, I can match up with anything. Then, on lap 16, silence. The motor dead and unresponsive. After running in first, it would finish last. Britton was shattered.
What happened? It broke down, Sammy.
Yeah, that was very unfortunate. But we were trying things that were just so avant-garde, so untried and so brave at the time.
In the cruelest of all ironies, on a motorcycle with every part single-handedly designed, machined, and manufactured, it was a $5 battery cable bought at a local New Zealand hardware store that did him in.
Thanks. Thanks very much.
The setback proved to be temporary. The Britain went on to turn heads and take checkered flags all around the world. It even made it back to Daytona to capture the elusive Battle of the Twins race.
We've had a lot of small victories in amongst the efforts, you know, and they're all very little moments, special moments, lots of them.
In a history long and rich, no other motorcycle can boast of such a direct line to the heart and soul of its creator. Sadly, John succumbed to cancer and passed away in 1995. But the Britain lives on, and with it, the man who challenged himself and the rest of the world and won.
He's got big shoes to fill. Riding something so irreplaceable, so awesome. There's got to be nothing like it in the world.